Okay, in the last session, we looked at kingdom and frankly, numerous indisputable verses, passages that talked about new earth, kingdom on earth in the future, and what the nature of it will be and how it can't possibly be in heaven. It's going to be on earth. There will be a kingdom on earth, and it will be literal kingdom on earth. And again, the same folks who want you to think otherwise also want you to think that the word thousand doesn't really mean thousand in the book of Revelation, that it means something else. And that they want you to believe that apocalyptic means symbolic. They want you to believe that you can't really understand and comprehend because it's all, some form of symbolism. Even though the word apocalyptic means the revealing, the disclosure, not the obfuscation. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's not the shrouding of Jesus Christ, the confusing of Jesus Christ, the symbolism of Jesus Christ. Apocalyptic means the unveiling, the revealing. That's why it's called the book of Revelation. So it's intellectual dishonesty. It's also spiritual dishonesty, but really it's intellectual dishonesty to try to twist things to say and mean things differently than what they actually say for the sake of your paradigm that you wish to promote. So I wish folks would pray about that and reconsider that approach. Hey, do you remember this? We were looking at this last time too, and I came here and I stopped and I was talking about restorationism and about how the beginning of the new heaven and new earth really is the beginning of the kingdom and why. So let's look at Isaiah 65. 2 Peter 3 is quoting this. It says, the glorious new creation. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem as rejoicing and her people a joy. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people. The voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her. Sound familiar? Nor the voice of crying. So that's new heaven and new earth there. Let's continue. Look down verse 20 in Isaiah 65. No more shall an infant from there live but a few days, nor an old man who has not fulfilled his days. For the child shall lie down 100 years old, or the child shall die 100 years old, sorry. But the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree, so shall be the days of my people, and my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. So this is during the kingdom. This is at the beginning of the millennium and into the millennium. You got old people and you got infants. You got a sinner. That's not after the kingdom. That's not after the millennium and after the great white throne judgment that it talks about in Revelation 20. Because dispensationalists, come on now. You want us to believe that the great white throne happens at the end of chapter 20 of Revelation, but then you also want us to believe that Revelation 21, between chapter 20 and 21, is new heaven and new earth, and that it's 2 Peter 3 and everything's nuked. And then we get a new heaven and new earth after that, and this stuff's happening. It doesn't fit. So see my videos on that and understand what I'm trying to say here is that new heaven and new earth has to happen at the beginning of the millennium. It just makes sense. So take chapter 20 and take chapter 21. They kind of run concurrent. They run together. One is an overview of what happens to the people, the players who just went through the tribulation. That's chapter 20. And then it takes you all the way through the millennium, all the way up through the great white throne judgment. Then chapter 21 kind of starts you off at the beginning, and it starts you off with the second coming, because you've got the bride in New Jerusalem coming down. Now, are we going to hang out in heaven for 1,000 years, or do we return with Christ, dispensationalists? Let's be real here. We're not going to be hanging out up there in heaven in our new Jerusalem for 1,000 years and then waiting for after the great white throne judgment, and then we come back. It's not That's not the way the rest of the passages say it, right? So dispensationalists have to rethink things as well. They shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth children for trouble, for they shall be the descendants of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring with them. It shall come to pass that they shall call, I will answer, and while they are still speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox, and the dust shall be the serpent's food. They shall not hurt or destroy in my holy mountain, and all my holy mountains, says the Lord. Does that sound like it's in heaven? No, but we're still in the context of new heaven, new earth, and kingdom. Let's take a look at that. Revelation chapter 21. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, or the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem. Now, they passed away, meaning that all the destruction happening during the tribulation period. If you read Revelation chapter 19 and the second coming, skip the overview in chapter 20 if you want, and then continue reading here, you'll see the narrative fits just fine. So you've got the second coming, and then we've got John is describing seeing a new heaven and a new earth. Okay, and you see New Jerusalem, holy city, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. So he's coming down to man. You see it coming down, and he's coming down with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more, neither shall there be any mourning or crying anymore, no more pain. Former things have passed away. So we're looking at establishing the kingdom and cleaning up the earth, the big mop-up process here. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. There it is. Right at the beginning of Revelation 21, at the beginning of kingdom, and that's Jesus on the throne, right? He said, write this down. These words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it's done. I'm Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, detestable, as for the murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all the liars, their portion will be, future tense, in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Okay, so if Revelation 21 is a narrative that happens after, not concurrent with, but after chapter 20, you've got a problem here because you just had the great white throne judgment. So where did the cowardly, the faithless, detestable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and liars that burn in the lake of fire forever, the second death, where are we talking about them? They're done in the former chapter. Understand? So chapter 19, the bride's announced, she's made herself ready. And in chapter 21, says, I saw new heaven and earth, New Jerusalem coming down as a bride. It's called the bride because just like heaven and God are identified together, because heaven belongs to God, the bride and New Jerusalem are named after one another because it's where we dwell. Continuing in chapter 21, then came one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues, came and spoke to me. Now, wait, are we saying that after 1,000 years that angel is still floating up around there holding his bowl and talking to John? So we're waiting until after the millennium for the new heaven, new earth. Okay, new heaven, new earth. 2 Peter 3, if we want to rip it out of there, we want to say that it's strictly literal and not speaking hyperbole about the tribulation period. Come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And so he carries me away in the spirit, and he showed me the holy city of Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God. So we're still talking about that same narrative there of New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God. That angel's not been floating up around there for 1,000 years carrying that bowl. So New Jerusalem, does it land plunk on the earth? I doubt it. That's how big it would be, just size, perspective-wise. And things are going to be so messed up by then, it's probably going to be floating up off the earth. That's huge. 1,500 miles by 1,500 miles by 1,500 miles are the dimensions. It's going to be sticking up in space either way. Describing New Jerusalem, I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb, and the city has no need for sun, moon to shine. Does it say there's no moon or sun? Because elsewhere in Scripture, we're told that those will go forever, and they'll be around as long as the Word of God is around, right? But there's no need for it, because the Lamb is in there, and His glory shines. The Shekinah glory will be thrown out over the whole planet, over the whole earth. So there's going to be a need for sun or moon, because God gives it its light. By its light will all the nations walk. So the diamond-like prism transparent walls will be flashing out light all over creation. But nothing unclean will ever enter it into it. Well, no, because if you want to say follows chapter 20, then you're going to say, well, the great white throne judgment has already happened. So how can anything detestable or false enter into it? But either way, nothing's going to be allowed into it. And this is concurrent with chapter 20. There's a layout of the temple, which is interesting. There's the references off to the right, so feel free to pause that. I don't know who made this. I found it online. I would give credit to whoever made it if I knew who did it, but I do not. But there's some helpful chapter references in Ezekiel in there. Here's size comparisons. So you see on the left, you have the same temple compared to the temples that have already been built in the past. Solomon's temple in the middle, orange over there. Herod's temple in the blue. And then the size of a football field, just for size perspective, there in the bottom, green. And the tabernacle, Old Testament tabernacle, and the times of the Exodus is in the brown to the far right over there. The angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright crystal flowing from the throne of God, and the Lamb through the middle of the street in the city. Also on either side of the river, the tree of life, with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. So that tree is going to be a fruit of the month club. I don't know how to explain it. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Why would the nations need healed if we're after the millennium and it's 1,000 years later and everybody's got their glorified bodies and it's after the sea? So this is during the millennium, the 1,000-year reign, 1,000-year kingdom, 1,000-year reign of Christ. Okay. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life, and they may enter the city by the gates. Outside are, oh, this is interesting, if this is 1,000 years later and we all have our glorified bodies, outside are the dogs, sorcerers, sexually immoral, murderers, idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. This is not unlike what we just read in Isaiah, right? Isaiah 65. So again, we have the tribulation period. There, the survivors of the tribulation, the believing survivors, go into the millennium. They have children. Many of the children are not believers. They live for 1,000 years. And during this period, you've got a bunch of unbelievers here. Satan is bound for 1,000 years during this period. He is not bound now because he's like a lion in the streets seeking whom he may devour. And he's also called the prince of the power of the air. He's also called the god of this age. And that does not mean that he's bound right now. Or his demons. When Satan is bound, his demons will also be bound. So it'll be idyllic during the kingdom, but it'll be demonstrating that man cannot say the devil made me do it. Man will continue to sin as he has before, just without all the temptation. Christ will be ruling on his throne with a rod of iron. So how exactly that works, we're not told in Scripture. So that is the end of that. That's just kind of a brief overview of the restorationist viewpoint. I have much more on that also on my blog. If you look here on YouTube, if you're looking on YouTube for this, there is an icon for articles on my blog page, my Wix site. And there are 9 or 10 lengthy articles that go into this at length. But that's enough of that for now. That's more on the millennium and when it is, where it is, and what the nature of it is, and what it is not. So I hope you find that useful. Let me know, comment, let me know if there's more questions that you have. But if you have some specific things you wish to discuss, I'd be pleased to answer them from my perspective. I can't speak for all dispensationalists. Obviously, if you're a dispensationalist and you strongly disagree with me about the timeline of New Heaven and New Earth, I urge you to read those articles or contact me, and maybe down below I'll put a link for that site with all my articles, and you can read that and pray about it. All right? Bye. Till next time.